Hey guys, welcome back to Zero's Maverick Hunting. And yes, Halloween is finally here, my favorite time of year. And I celebrate it all October long with watching scary movies, watching Halloween specials, and of course playing spooky games. Now, in the past when I've done this series, I've done a lot of stuff that's vampire related. Ghosts and Goblins, Witches and Vampires, Death Smiles, and even last year I did Mona the Vampire. So this year I'm all prepared for the vampires. So let's get our trusty cross, trusty garlic, and I've got my trusty whip. And while it's not a vampire killer, I'm sure it'll do the trick. Anyways, let's check out Nosferatu on the Super Nintendo. For those unaware, Nosferatu is a 1922 German silent horror movie based on Bram Stoker's Dracula novel. Despite the filmmakers' best efforts to make it different from the source material, since they didn't actually have the rights to make Dracula movie, they changed nearly everything about it. Unfortunately, it wasn't enough as Stoker's estate sued the film company and all copies were ordered to be destroyed. However, a few copies of the movie did survive, and in 1929 it was released in the United States and is considered a horror classic today. It is a very creepy and artistically done horror movie that is just perfect for the silent era. It's also public domain, so if you want to watch it, there's no worries about downloading it and seeing it for yourself. However, we're not going to talk about the movie. There's already plenty of videos on YouTube that talk about it, and to be honest, I'm probably not the right person to talk about scary movies. But what we are going to talk about is the 1995 platformer for the Super Nintendo made by Sega. In Nosferatu for the SNES, you play as Kyle, who is off to rescue his girlfriend Erin from Nosferatu. So your standard late 80s, early 90s platformer plot. Yeah, I didn't say it was an expansive story. For as little story as there is, the presentation is wonderful. It makes you think the game has a deeper plot than it actually does. I'm not going to spend a ton of time on the story for a game that isn't based around it. Most games from this era kept the plot simple, unless it was an RPG where the plot was very crucial to the gameplay. Like most platformer stories, it's not really more complex than the plot for Super Mario Bros., so I'm not going to give the game shit for it. What the game does have is solid gameplay. Nosferatu plays much like a mix of puzzle platforming and street brawling. Think of Prince of Persia mixed with Ninja Warriors. Allow me to explain. The platforming is very precise and fluid, much like Prince of Persia, and the combat is kept 2D and fast-paced, much like Ninja Warriors. It takes both elements and mixes them well to keep consistent. Most of the time you're going to be doing precise platforming in these giant level segments, avoiding traps, jumping across gaps, and rhyming to make sweet raps. You claim to be a player, but I fucked your wife. Combat is a mode you switch into, which allows for single button combos and special moves which can be upgraded. The reason I compare this game so much to Prince of Persia is, well, look at the things you can do and how fluid it is. Kyle can climb, dash, slide, and push certain objects to reveal more paths. There's a lot of options when trying to get around, and it all feels very free-roaming. I think my favorite aspect, though, is the combat, as it makes you feel like a badass. Kyle doesn't have any weapons, so his only form of attack is his fists. You see that? I just punched Frankenstein's monster so hard he melted. And check out the first boss. Kyle just shoulder charged the Wolfman, and it's the Wolfman who had to hide from him.
Let this be a lesson. Don't fuck with Kyle!
As for the game's difficulty, it starts out pretty average and slowly gets harder. Part of the challenge is based on how complex the stage layouts become, with levels becoming small mazes. And the controls, let me explain. For the most part, the game controls fine. However, there is a sort of input lag that is noticeable. It becomes very apparent in the last levels when jump precision is key. Not only that, the slide move is needed a lot, and in order to do it, you need to get a running start. So because of the input lag, sometimes the slide won't work, meaning I would run into enemies I was trying to avoid. On top of that, you have to switch between normal and combat mode before you can perform any actions. And if you want to get a running start, you have to be in combat mode, making some longer jumps later on very frustrating. Not only that, but this game has falling damage. If you fall from too high, it just adds to the frustration. If dying from input lag isn't enough, the later levels have traps that can insta-kill you. Most traps early on do a portion of damage, but partway through the game they start introducing one-hit kill traps, which are hard to avoid thanks to input lag. What it boils down to is the controls really needed to be refined, and transitioning from normal to combat mode really needs to be streamlined. However, once you get used to the controls, it becomes easier to manage. Not to mention, the game has unlimited continues and a level select code if you want to stop and continue your progress later. And the best part is, the level select knows what upgrades you should have by that point, so they're unlocked by default. Speaking of, the game is filled with power-ups where you can upgrade your health, power, and techniques. Sadly, there are no weapons or projectiles, which isn't a huge loss, but some enemies are really tough to take down, and a throwing weapon would have been nice. The best parts of the game are the boss battles, and there's 6 in total. I won't spoil them all, but they're all challenges up until Nosferatu himself, who was the most challenging. What's nice is each boss has a distinct strategy, and if you're fast and clever enough, you can find their weakness and use it to your advantage. Nosferatu is the most difficult, as he should be. It's a fight that requires timing and precision to a T. I'll admit, I couldn't beat him, and I know what people will say about me not finishing the game, but in this case, I think it's warranted given the game is so good, I had to talk about it. When all said and done, Kyle is reunited with Aaron, and the credits roll as we watch them ride into the dawn, just in time to see the sunset. I mentioned earlier how the presentation is very well done. The game has both impressive visuals in both in-game and cutscenes. Yes, this game has cutscenes, and they're beautiful. I'm actually really impressed with how fluid and vivid cutscenes are. They're almost FMV-esque, which is very impressive considering this is on a Super Nintendo cartridge and not a CD. Usually when cutscenes get converted to sprites, they are very hard to make believable, but Seda pulled this off masterfully. The in-game graphics are well done as well. Kyle, some of the bosses, and larger enemies have very detailed sprites that remind me even more of Prince of Persia, or Out of This World. Speaking of Out of This World, I'm impressed with the fluid animation for Kyle that's even better than the 2 games I just mentioned. The sound department is also great, having appropriate sound effects for everything. I'm not sure if stock sounds were used, but if they were, they used some lesser known ones. Punches and impacts feel real and satisfying, and jumps feel just as risky thanks to the sound. The music is ambient and dark for the most part, giving it a great gothic horror tone. My only complaint is I wish there was a less subtle boss theme. It would really hype up battles if we got some more heart-pounding music. Also, that ending theme is awesome. Probably my favorite track in the game.
Now, with all of that said, what are my final thoughts on Nosferatu for the Super Nintendo?
It's a very good game that has flaws. If you're into games like Prince of Persia, Out of This World, or even Super Metroid, you'd probably enjoy this game. While the game has a lot of action, the gameplay is more emphasized on platforming. Castlevania, this is not. But regardless, it's a really fun game worth checking out for the SNES. Sadly, the game is kind of uncommon, with European and Japanese copies going for around $50 to $75 range, and North American copies around $200 to $300. It's sad too, as I really think this game deserves more attention, especially when compared to the absolute garbage Bram Stoker's Dracula for the SNES, which is a much more common game.
Regardless, Nosferatu for the Super Nintendo is a fantastic game. Just be prepared to pay a pretty penny if you see it in retail. And if you see it in the wild, have at her! It's a great game you should add to your collection. Anyways guys, thanks for watching Zero's Maverick Hunting for Halloween 2017. I'll see you next time. Anyways, guys, thanks for watching Zero's Maverick Hunting for Halloween. I'll see you next time. I just knocked down my figures.
Hey guys, thanks for watching my Halloween review. Before I get to the end slate, I'd like to do a little bit of advertising here. First off, my artist Danny, she has rebranded her site to dancreates.co.uk, so if you'd like some art, she's open for commissions. I'd like to thank Nintendo Complete. I used most of the footage for this review from them because I copied the wrong footage over to my drive before I headed out here to Halifax, so that's a thing. On the left should be my last review, which was the Power Moves review for my anniversary. On the right, I'll be putting links to some playthroughs I did this year for Terror Time for Massacre Month. It was kind of like a month-long horror games thing. As always, if you like this video, give it a like, share around with your friends, subscribe to my YouTube channel for more reviews like this, and don't forget to follow me on Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, Instagram, social media galore. Happy Halloween. See you later.